Well, I like to draw and like to draw early. I remember I went through a Catholic school education, so there was no drawing for the first 8 years, and then I went to Aquinas and there was no art at Aquinas. So then I went to Villanova and there was no art in Villanova. So Catholics were rather rigid on art was a different thing. Very suspect people that drew really, had to be handled cautiously. So I secretly drew. And I drew with a pencil, and then kept on drawing and kept on sketching. I won't say Villa. We had took engineering, and I took we had a mechanical drawing class, and one of them we had to draw things quite formally, and they were sent down to one of the shop rooms, and you were supposed to draw some motors or engines or whatever, a couple things that were down there. And so I drew one. It was a pump. It was a pretty big pump, and it had some pipes that come up, and I cut the pipes off. And I was pretty proud of a little sketch I made. And at Villanova, it was a group of what they call day hops, people who came in from Philadelphia and spent the day at school and then took the trolley back to Philadelphia. And one of the people, he said, Leo, he said, I was assigned the same thing you were. He said, could I borrow your sketch? And he said, I just want to look at it. And he said, I'll return it to you.
Yeah.
So, being not too bright, I turned it over to him, and a couple days later, we were in this drafting room, and the teacher was in this glass enclosed office area, and we had these big drawing boards all around, there were quite a few of us. So he's knocking on the window, and he's saying, you. So he called me and this friend that copied it. We went into the office, and he just laid down the drawings. He said,
who's the plagiarist?
No, he didn't ask. He said, one of you can draw. And he said, somebody's kind of stupid. He said, if you're going to copy something, he said, don't cut the pipes at the same level. He said, I don't want to hear your story. I don't know why I want to hear how it came about. Everybody gets a D. Go out and do something.
Oh, a D.
Philadelphia.
So where is that person today?
Yes.
Stealing from somebody else.
Somewhere. Yeah, right. Oh, man. So when I came back to Rochester, and then I got involved slowly I always admired the watercolor section that the Rochester Art Club had, and the shows that they had every year. There was some very big names, Ralph Avery being one, but escaping now the gentleman from Batavia that moved out to California, but he painted him. He and Ralph Avery used to win all the first prize watercolor awards every year at the American Watercolor. And so I always wanted to take a watercolor course somewhere, and that's another story. In the evening, I went down to take to RIT when they were at the Brevard Gallery in downtown. So I went to sign up, and I said, I want to take a watercolor course. And they said, well, what's your background in art? And And I said, I didn't have it. He said, well, you have to have the prerequisites. You have to have sketching and pencil drawing and perspective and whatever, three or four courses. And I said, no, all I want to do is take the water. He said, no. You won't be allowed in any of this unless you get through. So I went screaming into this, some sort of overall course on drawing. But I had more fun in that course. It was the great things that I never, the one was drawing your, looking at your hand and then drawing it over here without looking at it.
Blind contour.
Yeah, it's just a, and then doing that with portraits, also.
Yeah.
Looking at a person sitting across from you and without looking at the paper. They came up. I think I still have, we just moved and I found some of those original drawings, in that it was a new experience. Every night or every class night was a different tool, and there were chalks and there were different pencils and there were inks, and I didn't know that. So I had fun. And then after I finally got to the side, said, okay, I'm ready for the watercolor, I'd like to take Ralph Avery's watercolor. Oh, he doesn't teach it anymore.
I'm ready now. Too bad.
Machine shops and casting shops and everything was at that time. Quite a few things. We're still cast. So someone had the wood chops where patterns were made and then the casting was done. And small parts, big parts. So it was quite a manufacturing center. We went down St. Paul and then you crossed over by Bosch and Lahn. In the two houses and the hot houses. But I remember this pattern shop, and he's casting every day, which was right across from John C. Gilmore. And this one next door was the dedication of the bridge down to the road. Yeah.
Civil War.
Colonel War. Yeah, it is. That's Mary Johnson. That came down to give a speech, and then because of the Civil War connection, they trotted out the reenactors, filled the bridge, and blew off the cannon. I know I was sitting on the bridge and they blew the cannon. Oh. Almost blew my ear away.
Yeah, because it's named after O'Rourke, who's a Civil War hero or some Rochester guy.
Yeah, he was killed at Gettysburg. Got to meet together from local people.
Were either of your parents artistic?
Any of my parents what?
Were either of your parents
artists?
Artistic?
No.
No.
No. No. No. My mother was a weaver. My father nor my mother saw high school at all, and they went to work right away, born in the last part of the 1800s. And I can't remember. I've got a book that has, someone took a picture of one of the mills down south where they had children sending the bobbins in the cotton mills,
mm-hmm.
and these were racks of spindles that carried the thread, and that was what her job was. And that once you put it on the machine, you loaded the machine, you spent all day putting these in, but you had to tie a knot, what was called a weaver's knot. She was very proud mm-hmm. of her weaver's knot, but she crocheted, knitted. Her crocheting was quite excellent. Yeah, tablecloths and did that.
That's artistic.
Yeah. My dad liked football and baseball.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about the tree piece?
Oh, the tree piece.
Yeah.
Well, when did you do that?
That was a sketch I sketch a lot of flowers and plants, and I get lost on this time of year, or have, in the warbler migration. So I usually spend the latter part of April and all of May and watching the warbler flights through as they come along, coming along the lake and in the parks. And so I have a selected group of parks that I would go with my sketchbook. And I usually kept a record, a sketch record on the back of the book of when I think there's some 30 or close to 40 warblers that come along the lake, and I get to see maybe 20 some of those or more. But I would draw a picture of each one of those, and then I had a little chart in the back of the book that showed when they appeared. But we were outside of Allison Park, and I would go there, and I would go out here to Mendon Ponds Park, and then there's a little park called Isaac Gordon Woods, which is in Pittsford, which is a beautiful little piece there. And so I wander around in there sketching the wildflowers and watching the birds. And the birds get sketched.
Mendon Ponds is where you fell through the pond in your snowshoes, right?
That's right, yeah. You know, I was out walking
through the ice.
Fell through the ice. Not too smart. But I thought I had a big wooden snowshoe.
Yeah. Too heavy.
I could span it.
That was your problem.
No matter what hole. Well, once you sink through them in the ice and you got those big, it looks kind of stupid. You got your hand. So then people tried to crawl out, seeing me down in the water. They're not about to get there. So they crawl out and people are holding them, and then the fire trucks arrive. They put things out.
Was that by this tree?
Yeah. Wasn't far. Was on the other side.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
So they strung a rescue rope to
to the tree. Oh
yeah.
Boy.
Yeah. So.
When did you
paint
that?
Oh, I was trying to think. It's at least 20 years ago.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
My God.
Yeah. These sketches go back, and I was looking. There's some in the back. There were Keoka Lake, and we were up there in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
We used to go up, so
yeah.
There's another 20 or 30 years on that.
How about the barn and silo, just beyond John's piece there?
The barn?
The barn and silo that's beyond John's piece, just next to it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That was...
Seems recent.
Well, I used to take various watercolor workshops, but you go away, sit at the foot of the master, and paint for a week or something. And this was a group of barns up in Arlington, Vermont, and they were hand constructed. The people that made the barn, they owned the barn. When I talked to them, it's a very different topping. It isn't round topping, and it isn't squared off, but they shingle it up and all around, sort of a layer at a tilted angle. And then you have a breathing area on the top. A gap, and then there's another overlapping triangular section that crowns it, and it's quite attractive. But I only have seen them up in Vermont. I've never seen them here in New York State. They're usually capped by the silo is a rather recent invention, farm-wise. It didn't occur until the late 1800s, 1885 at the earliest, maybe 1890, when silos came into being. And so what, when you see them, they're not ancient history at all. They're a really recent invention. And so a lot of the tops are just metal tops. But the ones up there were nice. And again, it was an all handcrafted. The whole silo was nice. And I sketched it, and it didn't work out. And I went back and sketched it again, and it didn't work out. I resketched it. And then I went back up another year later and went back to the same spot. I got a lot of drawings of favors of that barn. And finally got it down to where it was just simple. And I had left out some of the farm implements. And I probably had some people in some of them. And got it down where the colors were nice.
There's no chicken.
There were no chickens. There's some people that have an aversion to my chickens. It's pointed out every time I put them in. What are they doing? I don't know. So I wandered through the city, and these are a collection of the different times, different areas. But quite a few of them are.
Your most recent is
Corn Hill,
right?
Yeah.
Well,
the
Corn Hill. That's beautiful.
Yeah. That show. Yeah. There's one hanging in the student gallery show. Right? Yeah. Which is Corn Hill.
Yep. It's a nice piece.
Yes. So then, I need Fred to tell me, stop, go home, start something else. Without that, I would continue with the chickens.
No chickens in corn, though.
No, there weren't.
There's corn, but no.
No
chickens. Now, did you know you can have 6 chickens in a round of coit? If you want.
Oh, can you?
Yes, you can.
Oh, 6.
Six.
Yeah.
I wonder if Chapel Oaks knows that.
I don't know. I'm
going to inform them. Okay. And it's legal.
Yes.
It's legal.
Yes.
As long as you're a resident of Arundicoit.
You can't have a rooster.
Oh, you can't.
I like roosters. Oh. I cannot have roosters. They want no noise. Just eggs.
Eggs.
Okay. So, be selective. Yeah. 6 selective.
Well, do we have any questions for anybody?
Can you tell a story about one of his pictures, paintings?
A story on one of them?
No, I we're going to tell a story.
There's
this painting here, on the lower one, with Washington Square. And people can see that. But that's a group of women called the Raging Grannies. And they're these older women, and they're progressive, and they make music, and they sing songs. And at that time, they were protesting our involvement in the war in Iraq. And Kathy and I know some of these people. 2 weeks ago, we ran into one of them. And we had been here, and we mentioned to her, her name's Elaine Johnson. He says, you know, Elaine, there's this guy, and he painted you guys up in Washington Square. And she was really interested in it. And so we had a computer. We went on Mr. Dodd's website. We brought that picture up. And she's sitting there going, oh, this is Sally, this is Vicky, and she was able to name all those people.
Oh, really?
That's
a great story.
So she didn't come and buy the
Not yet, no.
That's so cool.
Now get them all to chip in and buy it.
Yeah, really.
Yeah. the Occupy movement that I spent some time sketching at the very end there, in front of St. Mary's Church. But St. Mary's Church had a, well, it was a big historical collection, because it was, when I lived in Brighton, there was a family called Gideon Cobb, and Gideon started the first brick-making effort, and Gideon's bricks are the what built St. Mary's Church. So that was always a big focal point, 1852 or something like that, Gideon put all that together. But my mother went to, she was at one time, St. Mary's Church was it, and if you were Catholic living in the city, you went to St. Mary's Church, and you went, if you could, to go to the school. So she went to the school, and Mary's mother also went there. So St. Mary's, and this, the region grannies there, that's right across, again, in the same park
as the Occupy.
Yeah. So I got a question. Did any of your boys ever miss church on Sunday and you could go to St. Mary's for 5 o'clock Sunday Mass? Do you remember that? I too went to a Catholic grammar school who didn't have any art. And I didn't go to Aquinas. I had it off.
Well, the one I remember at St. Mary's, I used to work at Hawthorne. Sometimes I'd stop for morning Mass or something at St. Mary's. But Catholic Church, very, very state, and it was why am I having trouble here? The Irish holiday here.
St. Patrick's Day, and it was
St. Patrick's Day, and they always had an organ. They had an organ loft and an organist that played. And it was always church music, but this day, leaving the church, I don't know why I remember it. But the organist played Sweet Molly Malone. Now, if someone had caught her, they would cut her fingers. You can't play Sweet Molly Malone on an organ. It's Catholic church. It was just, so I sat and listened to Sweet Molly Malone. It was beautiful. But things were so staid, so ritual, that she didn't. But nobody told her she wasn't supposed to play. So there we were, listening to Sweet Molly Malone. That was great. All right.
Thank you.